Good evening, everybody. We once again feel blessed to greet you from Mwanza. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen. Every now and then, we are receiving messages from active downlink sites, and you have been faithful in giving us reports. Especially Malawi has been in the forefront. Pastor Kuyama in Kawale Church, are you there? Thank you for the good reports you're sending in regularly. God bless you. Tonight, we are delighted to mention North Kivu Field Mission. You have a good attendance of 500 plus in each of your five sites. Pastor Bakulu Kizunzu, in your next fax, look forward, and we're looking forward to hearing reports on baptism. Brother, move forward with power of faith. Send us reports through our fax number in Mwanza and email address provided on the screens every night. I want to remind you that this coming Sabbath, we'll be worshiping together, and the hour of worship will be uplinked. We want to encourage you to join us wherever you may be. Remember, when Africa for Christ 2001 winds up, don't pack up your satellite equipment, because Acts 2001 series by Mark Finlay will be picking for continuation from Papua New Guinea, July 8th to 21st, 2001. This is another exciting series of meetings which you don't want to miss. Keep that in mind. Good news from Kibaha. Thank you, Brother John Bundi. You have offered your compound to God's people. And the satellite dish has been installed for you and the people of God there. And one special thing you have done, you have allowed them to use your house as a house of worship on Sabbath. God bless you for the good spirit you have shown, brother. Pastor Mungruta, visit the man and attend to his spiritual need. Amen. Once again, we want to seek the presence of our God and Master. It is my joy to present to you a brother in Christ, fellow servant, and minister in the cause of our Lord Jesus Christ, Education Director for Eastern Africa Division, Dr. Hudson Kibuka, will be leading us to the throne of grace as we rise in reverence for prayer.
Please rise. Shall we pray? Our God, our Father, Creator of heaven and earth and everything that is in them, we glorify you and praise your name this evening, because you have brought us together here and in the many sites around the world to listen to your word. We thank you because you always send us messengers to give us messages that bring us back to you. Loving Father, we pray this evening that you open our hearts, that we may receive your word, and that, Lord, at the end of it all, we may be changed and brought closer to you. Thank you, Father, for the many people who have gathered here. Thank you, Father, for the people who have gathered at the various sites around the world. And, Father, we want to place the speaker into your hands, that you may use him once again tonight to bring the word of your word to your people and bless us all. For we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
took my sins away. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And keep me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away. He took my sins away. No condemnation ever in my heart. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. His perfect peace he did to me in part. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And keep me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away. He took my sins away. Sins away, he'll take your sins away and keep you happy in his love each day. He'll take your sins away. He took my sins away, he took my sins away and keep me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away. 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 And keep me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away. He took my sins away.
I'm gonna tell about the coming of the judgment. Fare thee well, fare thee well. I'm gonna tell about the coming of the judgment. Fare thee well, fare thee well. There the better day are coming. Fare thee well, fare thee well. There the better day are coming. Fare thee well, fare thee well. In that great a getting up morning. Fare thee well, fare thee well. That great a getting up morning. Fare thee well, fare thee well. When you see the light in a flashing, fare thee well, fare thee well. When you hear the thunder crashing, fare thee well, fare thee well. When you see the stars are falling, fare thee well, fare thee well. When you hear the chariots rolling, fare thee well, fare thee well. In that great a getting up morning, fare thee well. Fare thee well in that great a getting up morning. Fare thee well, fare thee well. When you see the lightning flashing, when you hear the thunder crashing, when you see the stars are falling, when you hear the chariots rolling,
a good news, chariots coming.
Good news,
chariots coming.
So glad,
so glad,
chariots coming, and I don't want to be left out.
There's a long white robe in heaven, I know.
Long white robe in heaven, I know. Long white robe in heaven, I know.
I said good news.
Good news, chariots coming.
Good news,
good news, chariots coming.
So glad,
so glad, chariots coming, and I don't want to be left out.
In that great
a getting up morning, fare thee well, fare thee well.
In that great
a getting up morning, fare thee well, fare thee well.
In that great
a getting up morning, fare thee well, fare thee well.
That great
a getting up morning, fare thee well, fare thee well.
Amen to that. Beautiful music. Amen to that. That gets us going tonight well. Tonight we want to introduce to you a special project. We have something that we especially want our downlink sites to pay attention to. This is for you satellite downlink sites. Tonight we have with us Dwayne McKee and Candace Thorpe, who are going to talk to us a little bit about a special DVD project.
Now let's start with Dwayne. Dwayne, how are you helping local sites continue to do evangelism after these satellite programs are over? Tell us about this DVD project.
You bet. A multi-million dollar project to empower laity and pastors for evangelism using DVD technology so they can preach like Dr. Jere Patzer. A DVD holds, I have one here in my pocket actually. It looks just like this. It holds 10 times as much as a CD. Looks like a CD. DVDs will play through every video projector as well as TV sets. Since DVDs are made of four movies, more moving scenes have been added to the presentations. The goal is to reach 2.5 billion people in the next 5 years.
That's incredible, wow, Dwayne. That's great. Talking about one third of all of the people that live in the world. We want the Lord to come quickly. So, Dwayne, tell us a little bit about how the programs are being specially formulated to reach a world audience.
It'll be translated into 40 languages, which will reach 98% of the world's population.
Wow.
They'll also be culturalized graphics, so people will see their people in modern day scenes, resurrection scenes, and the heaven scenes.
So now what can the downlink sites expect as far as the equipment?
Every downlink site in Africa receives a DVD player, New Beginnings DVD disc with 25 sermons, CDs with illustrated sermon outlines for each sermon, a value of $250,000, $250,000. Training will be provided for all participating churches, a partnership with ASI, which is an Adventist lay group in North America, businessmen, Advent Digital Media, Pastor Don Gray works with that, a ministry of It Is Written Television Ministries, and the North Pacific Union Conference, drawing on the graphic resources of the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
That's great. Now I'd like to talk to Candace a little bit. Candace, you are coordinating the translating with the World Divisions. Now, how is the translating process going, and what news are you receiving from the field?
Well, we're really excited to be a part of this exciting project and to partner also with ASI and these other entities. We have already the first four languages in process, and that is Kiswahili, French, Spanish, and Portuguese.
Right.
And very soon, within the next week, 10 days or so, we will be getting three additional languages. So we're very, very excited about this. And we want to thank ASI for the tremendous contribution that they are giving to the world field in providing this excellent evangelism resource. Thank you, ASI.
Yes, thank you. Now, you and I were talking about some reports that you'd got some emails. Do you remember those stories?
Yes, I sure do, Natalie, and thanks for reminding me. Just today, we got a report from Ghana through our coordinator at the Africa Indian Ocean Division office, Brother Donkwa, and he's telling us that 135 downlink sites in Ghana, of those downlink sites, 131 are fully participating in this program.
Wow.
And will therefore qualify
Amen. That's great.
Part of this exciting offer. But we've heard also from other countries across Africa, a number of countries. In fact, I think the total right now, Dwayne, is sitting at about 554
wow.
DVDs.
Wow.
And that's only with about six different countries reporting. So we're really waiting for some more reports. So if you are watching this program and have been participating every evening, you need to notify your union coordinator that your church is involved and make sure that your name is on the list so you don't miss out.
Yes, thank you so much, Dwayne and Candace. We've appreciated having you here. Our second part to our special feature tonight is going to feature Pastor Joseph Dzombe. He is one of the youth directors for the Tanzania Union, and we have asked him to come out and share with us a little bit about the Pathfinder groups. They have been doing an excellent job during our local pre-program, and we are so proud of them, Pastor Dzombe. We want to show them off tonight.
All right. Well, Pastor, tell us a little bit about the Pathfinders here in this area. How many groups are there, and roughly how many people are participating?
Yeah, in this area we have 15 Pathfinder clubs who are participating in this area.
Wonderful. Now give me a rough idea of the ages of the children as well.
Yeah, it's from 10 to 15 years of age.
Good. Okay. Now, in all of Tanzania, you were telling me some neat numbers. In all of Tanzania, how many children you have involved in the Pathfinders?
Yeah, we have 33,000 children are involved in Pathfinder clubs.
Wonderful. Yes. Wonderful. I can remember being in Pathfinders, Natalie, working on those crafts like the clouds or the knots. I don't think I still know the difference between a granny and a square knot, but that's okay, I guess. So we're proud of your Pathfinder program that you're working on.
Yes, it is great.
Here.
Now tell us, what are some of the programs that your children, the Pathfinder children, are involved in?
Yeah, they're involved also in conducting a campaign to various places, and also they're involved in outreach programs, visiting churches and homes, and sometimes we involve them in camps. We go with them outside of their churches, and we do some sort of trainings over there.
Yes. Great. It's so neat to see these Pathfinders. We'd like to introduce now the Karumba Pathfinder Club. And if you've been listening real close, satellite audience, you know that the stadium is the Karumba Stadium. So this is one of our local Pathfinder groups. They're going to sing the Pathfinder song for us. They're going to recite their pledge, their laws, their motto, the aim, and they're going to talk about some of the Adventist youth leaders. Thank you, Pathfinders, for being here. We're excited to see what you have for us.
Pathfinder song. Oh, we are the Pathfinder strong. Please start.
Oh, we are the Pathfinder strong. There's ever the Lord are we. Then you as we march along into the purity. A message to take to the world and to let us set us free. King Jesus, the Savior's coming back for you and me.
Pledge.
By the grace of God, I'll keep you in heaven and true. I'll keep the Pathfinder law. I'll be a servant of God and a friend to man. The Pathfinder law is for me too.
One.
Keep the morning watch.
Two.
Do my honest part.
Three.
Care for my body.
Four.
Keep the rainbow eye.
Five.
Keep out and obey.
Six.
Walk up with the sanctuary.
Seven.
Keep the song in my heart.
Eight.
Go on, God's hands.
Eight.
Leadership of youth ministry from General Conference up to the church.
General Conference, Baraka Mganda. Division is Austin in Pune.
Union Joseph Nizombe is a representative of areas Kasika.
Conference Cleaver and Yotieno.
Church, oh, Pathfinder Club, Nemia Boaz.
Are you ready?
Ready.
Would he take me? Did he really? Can he? Could he? Would he? Yes, he can. He could.
can he save me? Could he love me? Would he take me? Did he really? Can he? Could he? Would he? Yes, he can. He could. He wouldn't. He did.
You can say you don't know necessarily so. Like somebody said once in a song. You can think what you choose, but let me tell you the news. The Lord has loved you all along. If you ask him, a friend, will the doubts ever end? Simply trust him and see for yourself. Singing, can he, could he, would he, yes, he can, he could, he wouldn't, he did.
Can he
save me?
Could he
love me?
Would he
take me?
Did he
really? Can he, could he, would he, yes, he can, he could, he wouldn't, he did.
Whoa. Can he
save me?
Could he
love me?
Would he
take me?
Did
he really? Can he? Could he? Would he? Yes, he can. He could. He wouldn't. He did. Can he? Could he? Would he? Yes, he can. He could. He wouldn't. He did. Can he? Could he? Would he? Yes, he can. He could. He would. Can he? Could he? Would he? Yes, he can. He could. He would. Can he? Could he? Would he? Yes, he can. He could. He would.
Wouldn't he did.
Oh yes, he.
Next Thursday, as we sing a theme song,
youth program.
I found our way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found our way in Jesus, even the way to heaven. I found my way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found my way in Jesus, even my way to heaven. No one can stop me now, no one can stop me now. No one can stop me now, since Jesus is my way. So hear me. Tumei ona njia, njia, njia. Tumei ona njia, njia ya uzima. Tumei ona njia, njia, njia. Tumei ona njia, njia ya uzima. Hata shetani apinge. Hata shetani apinge, hata shetani apinge, Yesu atahubiriwa.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, everyone. What an incredible evening here. That music, the special features, everything. It just keeps getting better and better. And I'm glad to tell you that this is not the end coming up. It is definitely not the end. Tomorrow night, very important message. The next night, a very special, special youth night. I want to encourage all of your young people to invite your friends to go to your downlink sites. Thursday night will be an incredible program, especially by youth, for youth. And then it goes on to the week, and then we'll be talking more about what's going to happen even next week. So God is good. He is tremendously blessing us, and all of you, for your support, I want to thank you tonight. Well, those of you in Luganda, Uganda, your greeting, I understand, when we would say it this way, Musibie Mutayano, how's the day in Uganda? Want to welcome you especially. Want to welcome you to tonight's program. And the Lord is going to bless us on a topic that is just incredibly important, because it seems like everywhere that we turn, someone is talking about the supernatural. Our topic tonight, should I consult a psychic? And it goes beyond psychics, because there are people that are looking at the heavens, looking up at the sky to see if the stars or that moon, which is right over me right now, that I've referred to before. Good job, camera people. That's the moon as of this moment over Mwanza. That moon or other celestial beings for wisdom about the future. What's the Bible have to say? If it's in there, we believe it. If it's not, we don't want it. We're going to open the Bible tonight and see what God says about this very, very interesting and deceptive topic. Remember, the other night, I told the story of Neil Watts, opening night, I believe, who in 1999 was in a commercial airplane that crashed in the South Pacific. Five people, as you'll recall, swam for 6 hours at night against the tides, fighting exhaustion, dehydration. At one point, speaking of that miraculous escape, Pastor Neil Watt says, and I quote him, "Right there in the water, I challenge the powers of darkness, Satan, in the powerful name of Jesus, who is greater, I command you to take your hand from us and let us get to shore." End of quote. And as you know, God answered his prayer. Now, friends, what does Scripture tell us about all those powers of the darkness that bombard us today, about communicating with the dead by channeling, the explosion of interest in psychic phenomenon? Advertisements on TV, at least where I come from, tell you to call a special number and talk to a psychic who will give you guidance and show you what you ought to do and what's going to happen in your future. And they'll solve your problems for you and help you if you'll just give them a little money. Well, what about those supposed sightings? The communication with the Virgin Mary, more and more frequently reported around the world. Is this God's chosen method as to how we are to know what the future holds? There are over 3,000 astrological columns in North American newspapers. 3,000! And people are trying to find out where they're going, what lies ahead, and just what does the future hold. Now, the magazine, that's one that I read, titled These Times, did a study on prophetic predictions. Listen to what the results were. Out of 250 specific published predictions, according to them, they found less than 3%, that's 6 of those 250, that we could list at reasonably fulfilled, and the other 97%, or 244, missed the mark completely. Of the things that were going to happen as predicted by some psychic, only 3% actually did happen. A number of years ago, in the news and much of Europe and certainly across America, maybe you heard about it here. I know at least one of our translators heard this story. Bishop Pike was a well-known American TV preacher and a writer. Some years ago, he had begun communicating spiritual mediums. And then several years ago, his adult son was on an excursion near the Holy Lands when he was lost. Bishop Pike, in great distress, as a father would be, flew to Israel to help coordinate the rescue effort. One day, as he was personally looking for his son near the Dead Sea, the father also turned up missing. Now this left his wife Diane, wife and the mother of the son, understandably frantic. And in desperation, she began consulting with a psychic to see if she could get answers to where her husband had become lost. And this was not a new experience for the Pikes, as I mentioned before. They had previously been involved with communication with spirits. Ultimately, both the son and the father were found dead. Bishop Pike, having not been rescued in time, was found dead of exposure. But following this experience, the bishop's wife was quoted as saying these remarkable words for someone who believed in the ability to communicate with spirits. This is what she said: "Of course, my husband and I both know that the information obtained through mediums is not always accurate." Not always accurate, Mrs. Pike, I might say, or should we say, seldom accurate. And Mrs. Pike even knew what the odds might be, and she still continued to talk with them. So tonight, psychics, mediums, their kind, are indeed misleading, friends, the masses. So if that's the case, then the obvious question for us tonight is, how do I find accurate information about the future? Listen to what God's word has to say. Isaiah 47:13. You are wearied in the multitude of your counsels. Let now the astrologers, the stargazers, the monthly prognosticators stand up and save you from what shall come upon you. You see, God is saying here, if these people can save you and can tell you what's going to come, then go ahead and stand up. That's what God says. If they can help you, stand up and be counted with them. If they can help stop what's going to take place, then why don't you line up with them? And speaking of Manasseh, king of Judah, 2 Kings 21:6 tells us this. And also he made sons pass through the fire, practiced soothsaying, used witchcraft, and consulted spiritualists and mediums. He did much evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. Now, this isn't the way God chose to communicate with mankind, even though it's been going on all these hundreds and hundreds of years. He says that when you and I start seeking a medium, an Ouija board in some parts of the world, an astrologer or a witch doctor in this country, to find out what the future holds, God says, no, this is not what I want you to do. Leviticus 19:31 goes on and says, give no regard to the mediums and familiar spirits. Do not seek after them to be defiled by them, for I, the Lord your God. You see, the Lord makes it very clear. This is God's counsel to you and to me. He says, don't seek this. Don't use these sources to try and find answers. It won't work. So then again, how am I to relate to these popular phenomena? How am I to relate to a person who claims to be a prophet? Maybe we should ask, are there prophets? And are there prophets of God? Can they see the future and tell me what's going to happen? Many people think this is the way to find out what lies ahead. And it's a question that you and I must ask ourselves as intelligent, thinking human beings, because there are many out there who claim to be prophets. You see, the scripture says that you and I are not to despise prophesying. It says that we are not to look upon it as bad. Listen, 1 Thessalonians 5:19 to 21 says, do not quench the spirit. Do not despise prophecy. Test all things. Hold fast what is good. So God says, you and I are to look upon a prophecy, not to reject or despise it. Well, if I'm not to despise it, what then? What are we to do? The Bible goes on and it says, prove all things. In other words, check it out. You're to prove it. Look at it. Examine it. And I must find out what it's right, what's correct, what's honest. And how do I do that? The Bible goes on, and when they say to you, seek those who are mediums and wizards who whisper and mutter, should not a people seek their God? Should they seek the dead on behalf of the living? You see, God says not to go to somebody who's a medium or a wizard. We're not to seek the dead on behalf of the living. Listen carefully, because God answers clearly that question. Isaiah 8:19 and 20 says this, to the law and to the testimonies. You've heard me say this over and over during this series of meetings. If they do not speak according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. In other words, dear friends,
there in the Highlands Church in Harare, where all you youth have been praying for us, and I appreciate it so much. This is how I'm to prove things. It must harmonize with this book, the Bible. To the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. See, once again, I've got to go to God's word first and find out what the scripture says about this topic. What a person is saying must agree with God's word. Not only that, very clearly, I want to say to you tonight, a sign or a miracle is not proof enough. Let me repeat that, because many people are confused at this. A sign or miracle is not proof enough that something is right. You see, just because you can see it, just because you might hear it or even feel it, does not mean that it's from the Lord. We talked about that the other night when we were talking about the state of the dead. You remember the World War I soldier who was lost in battle. And his mother went to a spirit medium thinking he was dead and communicated with supposedly her son, whom she loved and was sure it was her son. And one day he came and knocked on her door and realized that she had been talking to a fraud, a fake. And at least that's what the scripture tells us about this very topic. This is what it has to say further in Deuteronomy 13, 1 and 4. If there arise among you a prophet, a dreamer of dreams, and he gives you a sign or a wonder, and the sign or wonder come to pass, of which he spoke to you, saying, let us go after other gods, which you have not known, and let us serve them, you shall not listen to the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreamers, for the Lord your God is testing you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. And it goes on, you shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice and shall serve him and hold fast to him. In other words, dear friends, I may see it with my eyes, I may hear it with my own ears, but if it doesn't harmonize with the word of God, I have to stand on the word of God. And just because I saw it doesn't necessarily make it something that I can believe. Must be built on the word of God, and I can't say that too strongly. We can't always trust what we see or what we hear today. You know, with the modern technology out there, we can be deceived anytime we turn on a television set. And that's what man can do. Imagine what the devil can do. You see, you and I must have a foundation that we can stand on. It says, I must test the prophet. 1 John 4:1, it goes on. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test these spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets have gone out in the world. So he said there's a lot of false prophets out there, and we must test them to see if they are of God. Let me ask you a question. What's the purpose of a prophet anyway? Well, the scripture tells us that the prophets are to help us know what's coming in the future. Amos 3:7, familiar verse. Surely the Lord God does nothing unless he reveals what? His secrets to his servants, the prophets. You see, God shows them what is going to take place. And you have a whole book here of people who were prophets. From the days of Daniel, clear down to the end of time, he showed them what was going to happen. We looked at Daniel's prophecies early on in this series. That's the purpose of a true prophet. And it goes on in 2 Chronicles 20:20. So they arose early in the morning, went out into the wilderness of Tekoa, and as they went out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem. And then the key part, believe in the Lord your God, and you shall be established. Friends, believe in the Lord your God, so you shall be established. In other words, established means to build your faith, again, on the Word of God. Now, some people are having questions about the Word of God, and they're not sure of what to believe. But we build our faith on the Word of God, as we've said over and over and over and over again these last days. That is where we stand. See, some people are just never solid. They're wishy-washy. That's what Jehoshaphat means when he says, stand on the Word of God. Be established there. Listen, believe his prophets, and you shall prosper. Friends, if you're willing to believe what God's Word says, if you're willing to believe what his prophets say, the Bible says that you will prosper. Last night we talked about God's blessings. This is one of those conditions. You will prosper if you believe God's prophets. Why? Simple. 1 Corinthians 14:3 goes on and it says, but he who prophesies speaks to edification and exhortation and comfort to men. Three things. You see, the work of a prophet is edification, exhortation, and comfort. Most of us don't mind being edified. You know, as long as you don't overdo it, because edification, the definition of that is to instruct so as to promote intellectual or moral improvement. So we don't mind that. That's fine if someone wants to instruct me. On the other hand, very few of us like to be exhorted. You know what that is? The definition of that is to urge or to incite by a strong appeal. If I were to stand up here night after night and just hammer away at you and tell you that you're going to go to hell if you don't listen to what I'm saying, you probably wouldn't like my message very much. You see, and most of us know well enough of our own sins, and we don't often need to be exhorted about them. In fact, maybe you thought that was the work of a minister. Maybe some of you ministers thought that was your job. But let me say to you ministers, even you and I need to be gentle, because there's an old saying back in the United States that translates fairly well here also. You can shear your sheep often, but you can only skin them once. Think about that one for a little bit and let the translation soak in. You see what it's saying? Because prophecy is not just for edification, but it says it is also, thirdly, for comfort. Comfort ye my people. And so the work of a prophet is for exhortation, for edification, and thirdly, for comfort. That's what a prophet, a true prophet of God, is supposed to do. That's why God places prophets at key times down through history. God has had prophets, as we mentioned before, all the way down through the history, through the Bible. He's had his men and his women. Moses was a prophet. You can read the things that Moses wrote. Isaiah was a prophet of God. But did you know there are Old Testament prophets who never wrote a word of Scripture? That's right. Never wrote one word of Scripture. The Bible says that Enoch, you've heard that name, the seventh from Adam, was a prophet. But you can't find a book by the name of Enoch, not in here anyway. It tells us also about Noah. He was a great man of God. He was a prophet. Elijah. Another one. And Elisha, his successor. They were prophets of God. Talks about all of them in the Scripture. They were prophets, true prophets of God. And you can go right on down through Scripture, and it talks about all of them. But it may surprise you that there are not only men who were prophets, but you know, ladies, there were also women prophets. Some people may not realize that. They think that all the prophets were men. No, the Bible clearly speaks of women who were prophets. Exodus 15:20 says, then Miriam, the what? The prophetess, who was the sister of Aaron, took a timbrel in her hand, and all the women went out after her with timbrels and dances. It goes on, after Pharaoh and the Egyptian army had been drowned in the Red Sea, tells that story. They went out and danced before the Lord, and she prophesied. She was a prophetess of God, the sister of Aaron and the sister of Moses. It also says there was another one, Judges 4:4, very prominent one. It says, now Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lapidoth, was judging Israel at that time. She was not only a prophetess, she was also a judge. In fact, it was under her leadership that the children of Israel were freed from bondage of the Philistines. Great lady. Have you ever heard of this one? 2 Chronicles 34:22. So Hilkiah and those the king had appointed went to Huldah, the prophetess, the wife of Shallum. She was a prophetess of God. So there were both men of God that were prophets. There were women of God who were prophets or prophetesses. In the Old Testament, listed one after another. But you know something? They're not only in the Old Testament either. The Bible goes on and says that there were prophets and prophetesses in the New Testament as well. It says John the Baptist. We talked about him just the other night. In fact, Jesus said he was one of the greatest of the prophets. We find that Paul was a prophet. We have studied quite a bit of the prophecies or the writings that he gave. Not only was Paul, but then there was one of my favorite writers in the Bible, John. He was a prophet of God. We have looked at some of those great prophecies that John gave in earlier nights. What about this one? Not so prominent. You ever hear about Agabus? It says he was a prophet in Acts 21. And as he stayed many days, a certain what? Prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. He is the one who tied Paul's hands symbolically in his feet. And he told them that if he went on to Jerusalem, he was going to be arrested, taken prisoner to Rome. He was right. He was a prophet of God. And then there was Anna, a woman prophet in the New Testament. There were the men in the New Testament. There were women in the New Testament. Luke 2:36 and 37 tells us about her. Now there was one Anna, a prophetess, daughter of Phanuel, the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, an old lady. She lived with her husband 7 years from her virginity, and this woman was a widow now about 84 years, who did not depart from the temple, but served God with fasting and with prayer night and day. And in Acts 21:8 at 9, it goes on. On the next day, we who were Paul's companions departed and came to Caesarea, and entering into the house of Philip the evangelist, who was one of the seven, and stayed with him. And now this man had four virgin daughters who, what? Prophesied. So it says that they all had that gift of prophecy. All four of those daughters. So what I'm trying to get across to you tonight is that being a prophet has certainly not been limited to men. There have been both men prophets and women prophetesses. And remember, another significant point is that many of these prophets and prophetesses did not have their writings included in the Bible, yet they were still true prophets of our God. The Bible says prophecy is not limited to the days of the disciples either. Do you know that? Because it talks about certain gifts that he has given to the church today for the end of time. It says God has given gifts of the Holy Spirit to the church today. It's not talking about a long time ago, even back at Christ's time. It's talking about the time in which you and I are living now. Says that God has given gifts to the church. 1 Corinthians 12. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brother, I do not want you to be ignorant. He's talking about gifts that he's going to give us. By the way, do you know why he gives the gifts of the Spirit? We talked about this the other evening as well. Good refresher course here. The gifts of the Spirit are to make your witness effective. That's why they're given. It says the Holy Spirit gives you whatever gift he wants you to have. 1 Corinthians 12, 7-11 goes on. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit. That's a spiritual gift. To another, the word of knowledge through the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, the gift of healing by the same Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. And to another, the discerning of spirits. To another, different kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as what he wills. So it says, friends, that the Holy Spirit gives us whatever gift he wants us to have. Now, some people have that all mixed up. They think they need to pray for a particular gift. You hear them praying to God to give them the gift of, say, tongues. Not that it's not what the Scripture says at all. The Scripture says you and I are to pray for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will give us what gift he wants us to have. Any one of those nine gifts that we just listed is a manifestation of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. One of those gifts that is given is the gift of wisdom. That's a gift that is given by the Holy Spirit. Did you know that? There are some people who have a lot of education, but don't have wisdom. And I know some people who have hardly any education, but they are very wise. It's a gift that God has given through his Holy Spirit. And then it goes on and says to another, he's given the gift of knowledge. That's different than wisdom. There's a great difference between wisdom and knowledge. To some is given the gift of knowledge. Goes on, to others is given the gift of faith. A great gift the Holy Spirit gives. You've known people who just seem to have a great amount of faith in their lives. They always believe that God's going to do something. And to others, he's given the gift of healing. And I want to tell you right now, I believe definitely in divine healing. I have seen the hand of the Lord touch people and heal them, make them whole. Yes, I believe in divine healing. But I also believe in doctors. We've had some great ones here that have been working as a part of this program. Doesn't make any difference which way God decides to heal us. It is still the Lord that does it. Whether he uses a doctor or whether he heals by touching somebody himself, it is still God who's doing the healing. And certainly I believe in it. However, I believe that counsel should be followed when it comes to divine healing, because there are counterfeits as well. False healings. And I believe we'll see more of those as time goes by. And there's the gift of miracles. Some people have this gift. To others is given the gift of prophecy. They can tell what is to come. It is the gift of the Holy Spirit. To others, it says, is given the discerning of the spirits. They can tell whether the Spirit is of God, is present, or whether it's not. And another is given the gifts of tongues. There's a lot of talk about this today. You see, some people have the ability to speak in other languages. I respect greatly all those translators that are up behind me, whose voices you're hearing right now in many of these downlink sites. That gift has been given to them by God. To others, he says he's given the interpretation of tongues. So all those gifts are given by the Holy Spirit for the purpose of making our witness to the world effective for him. So you need to follow the Scripture's instruction concerning spiritual gifts, because today I'm afraid they're abused, particularly when it comes to the gift of tongues. Now, I'd like to say right now again, folks, Some of you out here tonight in this great stadium, many of you out in these downlink sites, may be believers in speaking in tongues. And I'm not talking about a foreign language, but I'm talking about the ecstatic utterances. I believe you know what I mean. I believe in tongues, but I believe in it exactly as the scripture teaches it, as you might guess. Let's see what the scripture teaches about speaking in tongues. This is what it says. First, for he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with tongues, unless indeed he interprets. Now, why does Paul say a person who prophesies is greater than the person who speaks with a tongue, unless indeed he interprets? In other words, what it's saying, if I stand up here tonight and were to speak to you in German, which I couldn't do much of, but my father could, or some other unknown tongue, you probably, most of you, aren't going to understand me, right? It wouldn't do you any good if I would preach to you in German tonight. And Paul is saying, if somebody isn't there to interpret, then you're obviously not going to understand it. It goes on that the church may receive edification. Now, brother, if I come to you speaking with tongues, what shall it profit you? Unless I speak to you either by revelation, by knowledge, by prophesying, or by teaching. He said, I have to say something that you can understand. If I can't understand it, I haven't helped you one bit. Now he goes farther, and he gives you clearer instruction than that. It goes on, yet in the church, I would rather speak five words, he says, with my understanding, that I might teach others also, than 10,000 words in a tongue. He's saying, I can talk to you all day long in a tongue that you don't understand, and that is of no help whatsoever. But I prayed you can understand. The scripture goes on, if anyone speaks in a tongue, let there be two or at the most three, each in turn, and let one interpret. You see, 1 Corinthians 14, 5, 6, 19, 27, 28, all those verses are talking about speaking in tongues. Paul is being very clear there. He said if we are in church service, somebody is speaking in a tongue, let it be two, at the very most, three. Now carefully, he says, that one is to speak at a time. He's being cautious. Doesn't mean that all three people are up on their feet, talking and jabbering at the same time. It says that at the most, there could be three, and let them do it, each one, in their turn. That's what he's saying. And he's not done. And he says very clearly, and let one interpret. Now listen carefully, because normally you don't see this practice as clearly outlined by Paul in the scriptures. He said, if you're going to speak in tongues, friends, let it be one, two, three at the most. Let it be one at a time, and then let someone interpret. But if there's no interpreter, let him keep silent in church and let him speak to himself and to God. Now, you may have been in some services where somebody gets up and he starts talking in a tongue, and when they get through, they ask, is there someone here who can interpret for me tonight? That is not what the scripture says, friends. It says before the person ever gets up to speak, they know there's someone there to interpret it. So that there's not confusion, so that there's not bedlam. So if you're going to speak in a tongue, then let's follow what the scripture says about it. And if you know people that aren't following it that way, it may be another one of these deceptions. Because the gift of interpretations is just as much a gift as in speaking in tongues. And God says that if there is no one to interpret, let him keep silent in the church and just speak to God and to himself. Pretty clear. That's what the scriptures tell us about speaking in tongues. But friends, I do not believe in going outside of what the scripture says on the gifts of the Spirit either. And it goes on. Let's look. And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. When is this going to happen? Says the last days. In the last days, I am going to pour out my Spirit, particularly on your sons and your daughters, and they are going to prophesy. Acts 2:17 and 18 says, your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. Men servants and honor maid servants, I will pour out my Spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. You see, that's a promise about the last days of this old world. The other night we studied that prophecy that showed us that we are in the last days. God says when we get to that point, he's going to pour out his Spirit. There's going to be prophecy. The book of Revelation, that last one in the Bible that we've been referring to so often, speaks about the remnant. Remember, we talked about that. God said that the remnant would be right down in the last days. And it reveals some characteristics of that remnant. Listen to what these characteristics are. Clear back in your Bible, Revelation 12:17. And the dragon was wroth with the woman. That's the church. Woman represents the church, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, that's the last part, which keeps the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Now, you and I don't have any trouble understanding the Ten Commandments of God. We certainly talked about those the other evening. We understand them. You stood to your feet in commitment to them, all ten, including the fourth. What John is talking about when he talks about the testimony of Jesus Christ may be new to you. The ball of Zambia, where there's 4,000 of you at that one site alone and you have all those other sites. What's Jesus saying here? Well, scripture doesn't leave you in doubt. It says, as we go on in Revelation 19:10, I fell at his feet to worship him, and he said to me, see that you do not do that. I am your fellow servant and of your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Get that? The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Just what we've been talking about. So the scripture says clearly to us that that remnant right down at the end of time are going to, one, keep God's commandments, and they will have the gift of prophecy. It says the spirit of prophecy will be among God's remnant people down at the end of Earth's history, period of time. These are two identifying marks of the remnant church right now, the last days. So we ask the question, has that happened? Are there a people who keep the commandments of God, all ten of them, lovingly obeying his Ten Commandments, and also who have the testimony of Jesus? Well, I want to believe that this gift of prophecy was manifested in a very definite way in the writings of a woman by the name of Ellen G. White. And I'd like to tell you a little bit about her tonight. As a girl, 9 years of age, Ellen and another little girl had a disagreement one day as they were walking home from school. The other little girl picked up a large stone, and in frustration and anger, she hurled it at Ellen. Just as Ellen turned around to look back to see where the girl was, it hit her on the bridge of the nose, struck her there, knocked her down. And it had been thrown so hard that it knocked her unconscious. With the help of her sisters and a man who owned a store close by, they were able to bring Ellen back to consciousness. And her sisters helped her on home. But medical science, as you know, back in the 1800s, was not that great. So this accident put her to bed for weeks, week after week. So all she ended up with was a third grade education. A little girl who'd thrown that stone did everything anybody could do to make up for what she had done. But still, Ellen was never able to go back to school because of that accident. At the age of 12 at a Methodist church, she accepted Jesus Christ as her personal Savior. She fell in love with Jesus as her Savior. And from that day on, it seemed as though all she would do was to try to walk as close to her Lord as a young girl could know how. At the age of just 17, a teenager, same age as some of you listening tonight, she and some of the other young ladies of the church were earnestly praying to God. And while they were praying together, Ellen White received a vision. And in this vision, she saw a company of people walking a very narrow path. She noted that a light shone on the path, and as the people walked in the light, that they had no trouble seeing the path, and they made it fine. But she also noticed that if they were to stop and didn't watch the light, they didn't walk in the light anymore. But then the light turned to darkness, and often they would stumble and fall off that path. Sometime later, when she came out of vision, she told all the other young ladies there what she had seen. Now, you and I have no trouble understanding this vision, because the scripture says, "Thy word is a light unto my path." You see, that's the way the word of God is. As we understand it, we have to just walk in the light of it as much as we can, as God gives us the power to do. Because if you don't walk in the light of what God's word says, then we're going to be left in darkness. And so from that time on, Ellen White had many visions. She had many throughout her lifetime. In the course of her life, Ellen White wrote down what she saw in these visions. And she authored more than 50 books. Books that include that well-known bestseller, Steps to Christ, which has sold millions and millions and millions of copies around the world. Another book, The Great Controversy and the Desire of Ages. My daughter, who's just the same age as Ellen White was when she had that first vision back in the United States, is selling those two books as we speak because they are so powerful. Point to the love of God and to salvation. Let me tell you, as friends, these are tremendous books. Desire of Ages, one of her greatest book, is on the life of Jesus. It is a marvelous revelation of Jesus and his life. And you know, today, it's believed that Ellen White is the fourth most translated author in all the history of literature. She is the most translated woman writer in the history of the world, and the most translated American author, male or female. That's not to her credit. It's to God's credit, because of what he showed her and what she wrote has been an incredible blessing to millions and millions of people, led them to a closer walk with Jesus. And I personally can testify to that fact in my life, as many of you can as well. And she didn't write just about Jesus. She wrote about a lot of things. She wrote books about the Bible. That's true. But not even just about the Bible. She wrote books on education. Did you know today that the second largest educational system in the world is because of what she wrote? There are schools established all over the world where young men and women are trained according to what the Word of God says. She not only wrote books on education, this woman with a third grade education, but inspired by God, wrote books on health, books like Ministry of Healing, Counsels on Health, based on the principles from the Bible that then went on to be translated into programs that in turn fostered hospitals like our own renowned hospital in Loma Linda, California, run and operated by the Seventh-day Adventist Church, established because of the writings of Ellen White. But what convinces me that she is inspired is not all the books that she wrote with only a third grade education. That's impressive, no question. But the accuracy, the beauty, the truth of her writings, and the fact that they draw me to Jesus, to want me to make me want to love him more, because the same sweet spirit of truth that I find all the way through the scripture is what I also find in the writings of Ellen White. And I can't make you believe that, that the desire of ages or steps to Christ is inspired. But I can do this. I can challenge you to get a copy if you don't already have one and read it for yourself and see if it doesn't make a difference. As I'm speaking here right now, I think of a young girl. She was about 16 at the time. She used to be in our youth group when I was a youth pastor. And she had no confidence in the writings of Ellen White. Some think she had heard or just because she wasn't interested. Finally, I said to her, Allie, I just want you to do one thing. I won't talk to you anymore about Ellen White, but I'd like you to read this book. And I gave her the book, The Desire of Ages. I said, just read it through, and then you make a decision. She was a friend of our family, so she took it. She said, okay. And she read that book through, and it changed her life. And she became a believer. She's a solid Christian today, many years later, because there's power in God's prophetic writings and message. You see, what God is trying to say to all of his friends is that he didn't run off and leave us. In fact, he didn't just give us the Bible and then say, well, you figure it out. No, there are still prophets in modern times that he's speaking through with special messages. You and for me, just as he's always had all the way down through time. But we need to check them out and make sure that their writings agree with this book. And then you and I need to follow that guidance. 1 Corinthians 12:31 says this, earnestly desire the best gifts, and yet I'll show you a more excellent way, says God. God is simply asking you and me to walk with him. Go to the scriptures, study it, seek what the Lord has to say. And friends, he will lead and he will guide and he will direct you. As you think about what we've said tonight, the message that God has placed on your heart, listen to the words of this song.
Lord, I come to thee just as I am, sore undone without a plea, I come, a prodigal son, mercy, Lord, forgive me, Lord.
That's beautiful. Thank you, trio. Wonderful message. Born again. That's what the Bible wants us to be. That's what prophets lead us to. A decision to accept Christ, be born again, to start over. We've been talking about that each and every night. You know, the bottom line of what we thought about tonight and meditated on is the fact that God has always had prophets down through time, and he's predicted that right now, at the end of time, that there would be a church that would keep the commandments of God, all 10 of them, and also that church would have the spirit of prophecy. And tonight I've introduced you to that latter concept. 10 commandments, we talked about that the other evening. You knew that we believe in those. Tonight you learned about his prophetic message. But you know, for every gift of God, the old devil is out there working, and you can just about count that for something true, he's going to have something false. For something right, he's going to have a counterfeit. And so that's why it's so tricky living when we do, down through the end of time. Because he is going to deceive. The Bible says he's going about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And if possible, to deceive the very elect. Friends, hundreds of thousands of you listening to me tonight, please, under the direction of God, spend time on your knees asking God to direct you, and then open his word to find out what is truth for yourself, not just what I've been saying. And then finally, find books like we've talked about tonight that have been given as a lesser light to point us to this light, to help us understand the beautiful messages of the Bible and pure, simple, everyday language that you and I can relate to. God's given us that special gift. It's his love letters to us, the Bible, and these other inspired writings. And I'm so thankful for them. Oh, the Bible is number one, no question. That's first and foremost. You've heard me say that over and over and over again. But there are other guides out there that are also inspired by the same Creator. Draw us to the Word and in turn to God. There's help for your spiritual journey. And that's what this is all about tonight. And that help doesn't come and looking up to that full moon up there or the stars or Ouija boards and witch doctors. It comes from his Word. Tonight, if you'd like to make a decision as we close this meeting, to yes, say yes to God. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us your clear word. And to say to him, help you. Help us not to be deceived. Then I'd invite you just to stand to your feet and recommit yourself to Jesus, to being born again. As the trio sings one more time that one last verse so beautifully.
Prodigal.
forgive me, Lord, I come.
My heart is broken, Lord, forgive me, Lord, I come. Before I die, may I be born again. Before I die, may I be born again.
Amen. Amen. Won't you bow your heads with me right now, and we'll ask God to come into our life. I want to pray specifically that he will not only help us be born again, because we know we need to do that every day, and so that song was so appropriate. We want to be born again, accept Jesus into our life, as we talked about a couple nights now. But over and beyond that, that we will not, after being born again, that we will not be deceived by the trickery of the devil. There's one more person anywhere in this stadium, or anyone out in these thousands and thousands of individual sites, of places, that wants to stand to your feet right now and say, yes, remember me in your prayer. Stand right now, and God will see you. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for the message tonight from your word. We realize that you have always spoken to your people from the very beginning. Adam and Eve in the garden, down through prophets, through your word, and right down to the end of time, you've given a prophetic message again to this church. Thank you for it. May we see the beauty of it, and may it help us not to be confused or tricked by the wily evil one. Lord, keep us in your love and in your care. One day, when Jesus comes back for his faithful, may each one of us be ready, prepared, excited to meet Jesus, and then be reunited with our families. In his wonderful name we pray tonight. Amen. Amen. Thank you for coming tonight. Tomorrow night, very inspiring presentation. Of course, the music was so great tonight. I don't know how that can be better, but it will be good. But following all of that, tomorrow night's topic, the coming of Elijah. Is Elijah going to come again? Many people right now believe that Elijah is going to come, and he's going to come to this earth soon. Let's see what the Bible has to say on this inspiring topic. Good night. God bless you. We'll see you tonight, tomorrow night, right here.